Hi, I'm Fred McNeil, and thank you for watching QACTV7. You're watching a show called Conversations with Fred. Each week, I have members from the community come in and tell you about their jobs, their programs, different activities we have going on. This month, we're emphasizing education. We've had the superintendent in schools. We're having people come from the public schools. We're having people come from the private schools. Now we have a Karen Fields come in. And Karen, thank you for coming.
You're all right. Welcome.
I know you're in the middle of work and a busy schedule. Karen, I think you're the president of the biggest work organization, union, if you will, on the whole shore. I mean, is there a bigger association on the shore that you know?
We may be. I'm not positive about that.
I always used to. And truth in advertising, I was once the president of this organization, okay? I always used to brag about that. I don't know whether it was true or not. In the old days, they said, yes, we're the biggest association to help students and to help our education. So first of all, thank you for leaving your busy schedule. By the way, how are you doing the first week back?
Fine.
Okay?
Fine. Yep.
All right.
Ready
that
to
was
go.
Always the toughest for me. When the kids were back, I'm okay. But the first week of the meetings and stuff drove me crazy. But you're doing all right?
Well, after last year, one thing we've learned is flexibility and perseverance.
Well, let's start with that. Before we go into your life, how in the world did you make it last year? I know I was married to an educator. One week the education and the grading system was this way. One next week it was another way. The attendance changed. One day it was virtual. The next day it was both. How did you all survive?
Well, we survived because we all worked together.
Good.
And that was on every level. Teachers supported teachers.
Good.
We had communication with administrators. We worked very closely with the superintendent, often meeting twice a week to iron out health and safety
Terrific.
Issues.
The Education Association
yes.
meeting and a regular mm-hmm. dialogue going on. Okay.
Yes, absolutely. Because often people think that we are adversaries. We're not adversaries, we're yeah. advocates.
It's a partnership.
It is a partnership.
Works. Yes.
It absolutely is. And okay. that's how we got through it.
Okay. And that was that, look at, to me as an old man of 74, last year, the last 14, 18 months, were the toughest, in my opinion, this country's ever had. How you educators did it, I don't know how you did it. Because like you said, if you didn't cooperate, and working with parents, working with kids,
Well, I have to say, I have to give hats off to our students.
Good.
They were awesome.
Okay.
They showed great perseverance, great grace. As personally, as a teacher who was older and some of the technology was new to me, they were my mentors.
I couldn't have made what you had to do with the technology. I couldn't have done it.
Well, I probably couldn't have done it without the myriad of children telling me which button to push.
Like my grandchildren. Pop, here's how you put this a button you push.
Exactly.
Okay, that's good enough. Well, thank you for making it through last year and all the educators, right? That was, and parents and kids, because that was a superhuman effort as far as I'm concerned. Karen, before we get going, because what I'd like to do in this show, and you've already touched on it, that's explain to the public what the Education Association is and how you work with the superintendent of schools, the Board of Education, and the parents and the kids. But first of all, tell us a little bit about Karen Fields, where you grew up, where you went to school, why you became a teacher, and what are you doing now?
Well, I grew up in Baltimore City,
okay.
in walking distance from the old Memorial Stadium.
Oh, wow. Well, I went to bowl games. Great.
Doesn't exist anymore.
Right.
But my father was a labor leader through the 70s.
You told me that in a picnic one
and
night.
Early 80s. So I come to this position with a lot of passion and heart about the importance of labor unions in general.
Great.
And understanding the importance of labor unions.
What union was he involved with?
He was in the IBEW.
Okay.
And at one point, he was president of the Maryland State AFL-CIO.
Great.
So it comes from my heart when we talk about unions.
It's in the DNA,
It's
right?
in the DNA, absolutely.
Now, did you always want to teach, or did you just fall into it?
I
had the head librarians for the county just said, well, you know, a job came for it, and then I fell in love with it.
Well, I started out working in government. I worked for Senator Charles Mathias.
Oh, yes, Mac Mathias, Montgomery County boy, yeah.
Before I had children, I worked with Congressman Ben Cardin, who's now a senator.
Okay.
And then I did community relations. We moved to the shore, and mm-hmm. I had children, and I was looking for a career that meshed with them, but where I could make a difference. And teaching
perfect.
Just was perfect for
the
me.
The lifestyle's terrific, right? When they're off, you're off.
Right, so if I could make a difference in a child's life, then that was important to me.
Okay, now where'd you go to school?
I went to the University of Maryland for
College Park?
College Park.
That's where I graduated. When'd you graduate?
80.
Okay, well, I cheated. I was 74.
Okay. Oh, yeah, 80. And then later on, I was a career changer, so okay. I received a master's from Notre Dame.
Oh, okay.
In teaching.
Good for you. Okay. Mm-hmm. And had you always been interested in teaching? I mean, obviously, you were helping by working with government agencies and the Congress.
I had been interested in social work.
Okay.
And I thought those two things meshed, but that teaching would fit more with my family. So okay. That's why I chose that.
Which is great. The greatest profession in the world, right? Mm-hmm. It's the best.
I think okay. so.
Now, where are you now? What level and what school?
I'm at Centerville Middle School.
Okay.
I am the ELA teacher, one of them,
what's
for
ELA?
Sixth
make sure
grade.
Knows what that
English
is.
Language Arts.
Okay.
And I teach sixth graders.
Oh, wow. That age is, if we can get through COVID, they can still hug and still like you, right? And they love you, right?
Well, yes, they do. They do. They're
middle,
awesome.
I taught middle school 5 years. They're wonderful, but it's a hormone-crazed era. You have to be careful, right?
Yeah, well, that's seventh grade.
Okay, you're right. Sixth grade, they're still hugging and kissing
yeah,
and liking.
Yeah, they're
right?
still, they're
okay.
good.
Carol, well, let me ask you this. Now, when I was the president of this organization, it was the Queen Anne's County Teachers Association, would you explain to the public who you are, who are members, and what's kind of your guideline, what's the mission?
Well, it was changed from teachers to educators because everyone that works in a school system on every level supports students.
Sure.
So our custodians, especially during COVID, were our frontline workers.
Never ended, did it? Never?
Our nurses, our frontline workers, secretaries, support staff in classrooms, teachers, bus drivers, we're all there to support the education
number one is children.
Of our yes. students. So that's why it was changed from teacher to education
and correctly
association.
So. Correctly
yes.
so. So
yes.
we have custodians and members.
Mm-hmm.
We have school nurses and members.
Mm-hmm.
We have paraeducators.
Oh, yes.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
and we have
bus drivers.
Okay,
oh,
bus drivers.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, we have teachers.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of an umbrella group for everybody who's helping our children.
Absolutely.
And that's our main goal, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Help the children,
mm-hmm.
okay? Now, talk about, you mentioned earlier, partnering with the superintendent. Like you told me, you met several times the superintendent. In my mind, the association is equal partners. I mean, in my mind, equal partners with the Board of Ed and the superintendent. How does that all work? How do we do that so our kids work out in terms of, is there weekly dialogue, monthly dialogue, discussions?
Well, if you're talking about our local association,
yes, yes.
There's different levels of involvement. We meet once a month with the superintendent and people on her staff, and I can pull in members and Art Pippo, who is our UNISERV
okay.
director, and we do that so that we keep communication going.
So there's always a dialogue.
There's always a dialogue. We're not always going to disagree, always going to agree, because if
my wife doesn't agree with me.
If we always agree, then somebody's not doing their job.
Right, right.
So that's cooked into the
cake. And all these discussions you're having is to make our schools better for our children, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, we're not going in there, no. It's that's two things that make schools better.
It's very specific. You know,
okay.
We not only have concerns, but as we found, especially through COVID, we could come up with solutions
sure.
because all of our members are really the boots on the ground
right.
who know how those policies affect children.
Right.
So I think it's helpful going in both directions. So we meet once a month. We have building reps in every building.
So each of our, I believe there are 14 buildings, if I'm, mm-hmm. something like that. So each building has a rep, okay.
And that rep, we meet monthly with our building reps. And that is the same thing on a smaller level where they're communicating with their principal. Okay. If there are issues that come up regarding the contract, teachers talk to their principals. If it's not able to be resolved, you talk to your building rep, and then we refer to the contract, which is also a very important piece
of
dialogue.
It's a working document that
mm-hmm.
administrators and teachers, right, all, whether it's a custodian, it's a guideline, and we all follow the contract.
Mm-hmm.
We have to, right? And it's
absolutely.
Fair.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Which is very fair. Now, what do you think, let me switch a little bit here. How is this year going to go? I mean, I'm thinking, like, I had my grandchildren, I had two of them, 5 days a week. They haven't been in school for 14 months. How are you going to handle sixth graders? How are all of these wonderful teachers going to handle kids that haven't been in school for 14 months?
Well, I think it helped that we came back in the spring
at the end
and
of
there
last
was
year.
The And that we will be teaching all of our students face-to-face, that there won't be students on camera and then students
so
in the classroom.
Everyone's back.
Everyone will be masked in the schools. That's Queen Anne's County just voted that, and we're very appreciative of Dr. Salins following the CDC guidelines.
So the minute you get on the bus to the minute you go home, you've got a mask on.
Yes, there will be breaks for kids, but it was very important, and she's made that very clear, that she's following the CDC guidelines in conjunction with Dr. Ciatola, and we were very appreciative of the board taking her lead and voting that way last time around. So children will be masked, face coverings, you know, keep socially distant when possible.
Following with the
personal hygiene. Sure. What's really important is that the adults really reflect what the behaviors we would like our students to have.
Sure.
So we put our masks on.
If the kids have to do it, so do the teachers, right?
Absolutely. Right. And I think that's really what got us through COVID, is how all of us, teachers, all the people that you mentioned before, we modeled what that behavior needed to be. And that, as you know, that's what teaching is all about.
Sure.
So that's what made us get through that, and that's what's going to help us get through this. And I really do feel, getting through last year, we are all prepared for whatever pivot is coming.
I don't know how you all did. I mean, I want you to know, someone who's been in education for 40 years or wasn't, I wouldn't have lasted a week. I saw what you all got. I mean, everyone, from the custodian there at 6 o'clock. I ride my bike around town at 6 o'clock in the morning. Every building was open. Someone was either scrubbing something or making sure that it was clean. Teachers going in extra early. I mean, one of the amazing things is teachers, everyone says, well, they got June and July off. But they forget, when you go home after a day at work, work begins again after dinner, right? You're preparing for the class. I mean, these are teachers that had COVID to deal with, protecting their own family, and then they were teaching. That's a pretty amazing effort.
Well, we were right in lockstep with all the parents that were behind their children,
right,
you know, working and making sure their children were in front of the computer. So the partnership with parents was extremely important. Basically, we were in their living rooms and they were in our classrooms.
Right.
And so that's really a bond.
Do you think, I mean, one of the things, my son, I have a son who's a teacher. He says, Dad, snow days are gone, fog days are gone. What do you think? Are they things that passed because of the virtual? Was that, no, that's nothing to do with, okay.
Mm-mm.
We'll still have fog days, we'll still have snow days.
Well,
maybe.
The fog delays are, you know, needed, but our contract has, fog delay language in it.
Okay, Karen, where do you, now look, let's look, fingers are crossed, and we're still on the edge here with this COVID thing. I mean, if we can get through this year, and if we ever can get back to normal, one of the things I keep reading in the paper, there's a teacher shortage.
Mm-hmm.
What's that all about? I mean, what do you say as a professional educator and a president of an association? Why can't we, it's a wonderful profession. Why, and it's paid quite well now, I think, why, or maybe we're not, you correct me, why are we having trouble getting substitutes and teachers? What's going on?
Well, I think we can talk about Maryland,
please.
Because if you're a teacher in Maryland, mm-hmm, your future is a lot brighter because the blueprint for Maryland legislation was passed last year.
Right.
So that is requiring a 10% pay increase for teachers by 2024. In addition to that, the associations all over the state, in conjunction with their local school superintendents, will be working on what are called career ladders. So if you are a new teacher or a mid-career teacher, there will be an opportunity for you to receive a pay increase based on certain criteria and student growth.
Okay.
So there are pathways. If you want to be a really awesome classroom teacher, then you're going to be rewarded
for that. So you don't have to go
that.
To administration and make money or become a counselor. And
exactly.
Wonderful professions.
Absolutely.
But we've lost too many good classroom teachers who say, look, I got kids going to college. I got a mortgage. I can't. I got to help myself. We're going to correct that, apparently.
Right.
which is terrific.
And guidance counselors are also in our association.
We won't forget them. Bob Willis is giving me dirty looks right now, which is good.
So if you're a teacher in Maryland, and the reason that happened, though, is because our state organization is the Maryland State Education Association. And they worked for years, along with teachers, to bring that legislation to fruition. And we're actually a role model for other states.
So Maryland is.
Maryland is, yes.
So there's a little brighter future for Maryland educators.
Absolutely.
And I'm going to push it as an ex-educator. Wonderful profession, right? Is anything as rewarding as you're in ACME and someone tugs your arm and say, hey, Mr. McNeil, I had you 10 years ago and you changed my life. Or you get it all the time, I'm sure. And it makes an amazing difference, which is kind of nice. Well, like I said, fingers crossed. You guys have done a fantastic job, men and women, whether you're a custodian or a teacher or an administrator, getting through the last year, I think is amazing. And I think the important thing is, Karen, and you said it, it's all about communications and the local association communicating with parents and administration and teachers. Now, if someone is watching this show and says, you know, I'd like to know more about the union or the association, is there a number, an office they can call? Should they go online? What if someone says, Fred's tip of the iceberg, let me get nitty gritty. I'd like to talk to
somebody. Well, we have a website, QACEA.org.
Okay.
And there's also the state website.
All right, so they can go to those.
MSEA.org. You can go to that. If you are work in the school system and you're interested in becoming a member and you're not a member, the vast majority of people are, but sometimes people slip through the cracks. They can always talk to their building rep or they can email me.
Okay, so the website, talk to a building rep, and parents, if they're out there saying, look, I'd like to talk to somebody, because you're obviously doing everything you can to make our schools better, right? Whether it's COVID issues, giving feedback to administrators, whether it's helping with bus duty, whether it's doing a wonderful job in a classroom, whatever it is. How you guys do the technology? I said this, no way.
If I can do it, anybody can.
Okay, that makes me feel better.
Yes.
I know, there's no way I can get it. Now, I have to ask, minutes we have left, do you still have the fall dinner, or has COVID gotten rid of that, or where
the,
are we? You used to have the barbecue and the chicken.
The crab feast,
I'm sorry.
We have it scheduled. We're going to play it by ear.
Okay, depending on COVID.
Yeah, everything is fluid, so.
Well, it's like our whole country right now. Everything is fluid. We don't know.
Yes.
All right, well, most people don't know, and the association president not only has all the concerns of the president, being president, but you also work full-time as a teacher, right? It's not as if you're sitting in an office all day as the association president. You've got from probably 8 o'clock in the morning to 4 o'clock teaching, right? Then you put on the association's president's hat, so it doesn't end, does it?
No, we've gotten our contract now. I have 7 release days.
Oh, terrific.
That I can use for association business.
Okay, which is the way it should be.
Which is really important. But yes, I have 2 full-time jobs, but they both are important, and I take both of them very seriously.
And like all the teachers in this county, all the custodians and all the counselors, the number one priority is our children, right?
Absolutely. I always say that we are stronger and safer when we work together.
And that's what the association's about, right? Working together. Well, Karen, I promise you, it's 12:11. Your principal's going to be happy. You're going to get back by 12:15 or closer, all right? Look, you and everybody, association members and I, have a wonderful school year. Please be safe, and let me publicly thank all of you for the great job you do, okay?
Thank you, and thank everybody for all their support. It's truly appreciated.
And again, last, if they have questions, again, they can go to your website, just Queen Anne's County Education Association.
.org.
And if they want phone numbers or questions, whatever,
it's all on there.
Okay. Yep. Well, thank you, and again, have a great school year.
Thank you.
I'm Fred McNeil. Thank you for watching QACTV7. My time's up. Thank you for your time, and we'll see you next time, and have a great school year.